History always seems to gobble everybody up, but it doesn't have to. It's tough to stay ahead of the curve here, and that's why people continuously get caught up in the net of history and the unfold and what's happening right now. Very difficult to get free of it. There's no question about that. There's one issue I can bring up, which is the one from last video that I couldn't remember. Of course, I remembered it later on. That is, okay, there's no such thing as a objective neutral stance. That is impossible. That's why Jesus said, you're either for me or against me. What he's saying is there's no such thing as this so-called objectivity. What does objectivity mean? Does that mean that God says, my creation and reality is just the same as the denial of my creation and the desire to annihilate it? There's no difference. They're both the same. Or is it saying like truth and lies are both the same? There's some objective state where truth and lies, they're both the same. Is that true? It's not true. It is not true. It's actually the ego that has been directing this delusion that there's an objective neutral state, and that's the goal of spiritual teaching. Of course the ego is going to promote this idea of just be the neutral observer, the objective. There's a state where everything is, you're totally neutral. It's the ego that has been promoting this teaching as spiritual teaching, and it is the most ruinous lie imaginable. What it's saying is that your desire to dwell in your true home, to experience your true inheritance, and to be as you truly are, and to accept reality as it truly is just the same, and you should not have that desire, because you should have equal desire to not dwell in your home, to not experience your inheritance, to not be as you are, to not accept reality as it is, and those should be equal. In other words, you're neutral on everything. That's not possible. We have within us the desire to be as we are and to experience as we were created to experience. That can never be gotten rid of, and that's the most powerful desire that we have. The ego says, hey, that's not fair, it's not fair, you need to be neutral, there's some spiritual state where you're just neutral on everything. Not true. That is just a dead end, actually. And yet this has been promoted as spiritual teaching for a long time. The ego is the one that is promoting this. There's no such thing as neutrality. As Jesus said, you're either for me or against me. You know, there's no neutrality. There is no neutrality. You're not neutral on the issue of what you really want. It's impossible. You were created and to function, and that's how you want to function. And you cannot be neutral and say, no, I have equal desire to not function the way I was created to function. And I'm neutral on the whole issue. It doesn't really matter to me one way or the other. That's total baloney. Total baloney. And so the ego keeps telling us we're not fair because we're not neutral. No, the ego is not fair by telling us that we're supposed to be neutral. That's not fair. That's the unfairness. That's like saying, well, whether I'm happy or depressed, I'm neutral on the issue. It doesn't matter. Whether I'm suffering or not, I'm neutral on the issue. It doesn't matter. Whether I'm in a state of complete mental chaos or a state of complete peace, it doesn't matter. I'm neutral on it. Of course the ego teaches this, because what it's saying is you should accept its advice just as much as accept the Holy Spirit's advice. To be fair. What do you mean fair? There's no issue of fairness in reality. What does reality need to be fair to? Unreality? Fair is a completely bogus, made-up concept by the ego. And it really saying that you need to follow its advice, that its advice is just as good as the Holy Spirit's advice, even though the ego's advice ultimately leads you to entertaining mutual exclusives, which causes this complete feeling of mental chaos and disorientation that feels internal. And the ego says, well, it's not fair that you can't accept mutual exclusives. In other words, it's not fair that reality is reality. It's not fair that God's creation is not fair to the ego. The ego wants to destroy it. So of course the ego says it's not fair. And so the ego says, well, the first step on the spiritual path is you have to be neutral. You've got to learn this neutrality. And if you don't have that, you don't have anything. Utter nonsense. And this is a very, very ruinous lie that the ego has been promoting. And many, many people have taken a spiritual path of saying, I need to generate this complete neutrality within myself. And nonsense. And that's why we don't have the bliss, because they say, well, bliss isn't neutral. Bliss isn't neutral. I mean, they're obviously desiring to experience this bliss instead of being neutral. In other words, the ego doesn't have any bliss to give us, so it's not fair to the ego to say, to accept, to enjoy bliss, because the ego can't give that to us, and we have to be fair to the ego. Who says we have to be fair to the ego? God? No, God doesn't say that. Who's saying it? The ego's saying it. And is the ego fair to reality, to us? Not fair at all. Because it's asking us to accomplish the impossible. And then claiming that it's not fair that we can't. What is this? It's just trying to maintain its authority. You know, that it has something to give us. It's like the ego saying it's not fair, it doesn't have anything to give us. Well, if it doesn't have anything to give us, then let's drop it. We don't need it. That's fair. That's being fair to us. What is the ego? The ego's nothing except we're trying to change what we are and we can't. So is it fair that we can't change what we are? What does fairness have to do with it? It's not possible, so it's not possible. Fairness only arises when something's possible and it's not being allowed or something, or there's resistance. No, there's no resistance to anything in reality. Reality is not resisting anything. Reality just is. So there's no unfairness in reality, because nothing outside of reality is possible. And everything in reality is being treated perfectly, equally, and wonderfully. So there's no such thing as unfairness. You're either, you know, Jesus said, you're either for reality or against it. Either for me or against, before truth or against it. There's no neutral state. And this idea of a neutral, objective, witnessing state that is very bad and very ruinous on the spiritual path. The goal is to turn our attention to the dream of the Holy Spirit, to turn our attention and experience the bliss of seeing no evidence of impermanence, no evidence of loss, none. And that's tremendously blissful. And that then solves the continuity problem for us, because we say, oh, this is so similar to reality. I have no problem with reality now. I'm not afraid of, you know, dropping this perception altogether. That's how it's done. And of course, this experience is tremendously wonderful. It's not neutral. You say, yeah, this is great. This is what I want. The other stuff's terrible. And the ego say, oh, you're so unspiritual. You know, wow, you're so far away from neutrality. You're lost. You know, you're lost in neutrality. Oh, you're not going to, you know, you're going to be written out of history. You won't be written as an adept, as a master, you know, as an enlightened one. You're so completely biased against what the ego has to offer, you know. So, again, the ego threatening to write you out of history, which, go ahead, because ego's history is going to be burned up to a crisp anyway. It's going to be gone anyway, so who wants to be in the ego's book of history? You are already in the Holy Spirit's book of history, permanently, and your place is, oh, so-and-so, their history was they perceived no evidence of loss anywhere. That's their history. And they flawlessly perceive this. End of history. That's it. So everybody has the same history in the Holy Spirit's book of history. So there's this taboo against experiencing the bliss of this Holy Spirit's dream of no loss, no evidence of loss, of any loss whatsoever. There's a complete taboo saying you're going to be written out of history because you've failed the ultimate test, which is supposedly developed this neutrality. So the ego sees enlightenment as neutrality, but that's a delaying tactic it uses. No enlightenment there at all. And we all look down on the ones who are supremely blissful, like, oh, wow, they just, you know, they're not neutral. What's wrong with them? We kind of say, ah, that's not fair to ego, because ego can't give that to us. So, but what can the ego give to us? Ultimately, the demand, only a demand that we entertain mutual exclusives forever. That's its demand, which is completely impossible. So all the ego is an impossible demand. So why do we need to be fair to an impossible demand? What's fair to an impossible demand? What is fair to it? There's no way to be fair to it. There's no fairness there at all. The ego is simply an impossible demand. So, you know, who's making the demand? We are making the demand of ourselves. So just stop making the demand of ourselves. Problem solved. And yet we have the continuity issue. So we keep thinking, no, I need to be fair to the ego so it doesn't abandon me, you know, so I don't get rid of it. So we pursue these paths of neutrality. So we're all, you know, people are meditating. They're working on this. Let me get into this objective state. Objective meaning I don't have any position on anything. It's not possible. It's not possible. Because neutrality itself is a position. And it's the worst position of all. And you won't be able to maintain it. And then you will blame others and say, well, these other people, these blissful people are interfering with my spiritual path. You know, and then you'll get into the progressive movement of trying to eliminate those people. Ego will advise you, well, the reason why you're not able to maintain your neutrality is these very wicked people who are in bliss are trying to seduce you out of your neutrality. And so you need to get rid of them first. And once you do, then you can be in this neutral state. So you see, the politics of the ego is always to get rid of something, you know, annihilate something. And so those who follow the politics of the ego are always on the road to war, to annihilation, to attack, always. Now, of course, they sugarcoat it and say, oh no, we're on the road to progress. But they're backstabbers, you know, they're absolute backstabbers. So they will get around to the attack for sure. And what is the ultimate aim of the attack? Anything that is leading to bliss, anything that's leading to the Holy Spirit's dream, anything that's leading there, the ego says, that's totally unfair. It's anti-spiritual. It's interfering with your salvation because you need to develop this neutrality and that's your salvation. No, it's not. It's just a defensive posturing because you're too afraid to let go of the ego. That's all it is. But you call it, oh, I'm being fair. No, you're being frightened. It's not fair, it's being frightened. We're frightened to let go of the ego. So that's what we need to recognize. We're not objective. How can we be objective? Objective is saying, well, the ego's advice is just as good as the Holy Spirit's advice. Is that true? I thought objectivity was truth. So is it true that the advice is the same? No, it's completely, they're polar opposites, and the ego's advice is impossible. The Holy Spirit's advice is perfect. They are not the same. So objectivity is supposed to get to truth. It's not a state in itself. We're saying all things are true. All things are equal. The ego's advice is equal to the Holy Spirit's advice. That's not objectivity. That's defensive delusion. That's fear, claiming to be objective. So we have all this fear claiming to be objective and claiming to be spiritual. It's not. It is absolutely not. So who's in harm's way at this time? Those who are on the path to bliss, no question about it. Because those are the ones the ego hates. And once the mechanism of attack gets going, there's all sorts of pretexts that are used. The goal is really to get to the Holy Spirit and eliminate the Holy Spirit, eliminate those who are oriented in that direction. That's the goal of all attack, attack, attack. This whole war machinery is going. And you may say, wait a minute, all these people are getting killed and stuff. No, they're just trying to foment the atmosphere of war. There's many people are willing to sacrifice their lives. If in sacrificing their life, it foments a greater war, which eventually comes to, you know, destroy the institutions and the focus of the Holy Spirit on this planet towards its dream of no evidence of imperfection, which solves the continuity problem, which enables us to set down the whole egoic training program of trying to teach us how to die. We're able to set it down then. So the ego, again, wants to foment war and destruction against all of that. And so it will use its agents to bomb, to die, to shoot, to do all sorts of atrocities, be involved in conflicts. They'll willingly, the ego will tell them, look, you're going to be a hero if you do this, and I'll write you in my book of history as a great, great hero if you do this. And people will say, oh, I'm willing to do it. Well, hey, it's easy to die, and I'll just, you know, activate a whole bunch of warlike attitudes in people and fear and everything, so it'll lead more to war and destruction. If I can do that, I'll be written in the ego's book as a great hero or heroine. And they say, hey, that's a great deal. I'll take that deal. That's what's happening. The ego is not, you know, the ego sacrifices those that are loyal to it in order to try and develop a greater destructivity that eventually comes down. You know, the ego wants to raise all the churches and temples and synagogues and everything in the world. It wants to destroy any evidence that that there's ever been focus on the Holy Spirit on this planet. It wants to literally rewrite history and say none of that ever took place. And so it wants to generate a great war on this planet. So during this great war, it will spill over far enough so people will start torching churches, bulldozing them. You know, all this destructivity will come down on the heads of all the religious people, all the people in the world who are at least trying to listen to the Holy Spirit. Not that they've done a good job. I'm not saying that we've done a good job here. But they're still, it's like a baby, you know. Don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. Sure, the bathwater's dirty, but people are at least struggling and trying, which is a first step. You gotta crawl before you can walk. So sure, people have been crawling on this planet. That's not an indictment of the Holy Spirit. It just shows you how much fear and resistance we have built up within us, and all, you know, that makes it the path difficult. It is very difficult. But if you really want to make it, dedicate yourself to it, it's doable quickly. You know, quickly. You don't have to spend many lifetimes actually. You do it quickly. You know, it's not an indictment of the world that we've struggled with this. The struggle has to continue. You have to learn how to walk. You know, we've been crawling for quite some time. Now we have to learn how to walk. And eventually you learn how to run, and then you learn how to fly, or float, as it were. So, it's not justified, you know, this hatred is not justified. The ego is totally unjustified in what it's attempting. It's attempting, again, to create such a conflagration on this planet, such an attitude of bigotry, intolerance, and hatred towards religion, religious efforts towards listening to the Holy Spirit, efforts towards clarifying these facts, spiritual facts, that it spills over like a tsunami of violence and destructivity and wipes that all out. And then all those who participated in developing this tsunami, the ego say, your star is in heaven. I'm putting a star for you up in heaven. You're a real hero. You know, look what you did. Isn't that great? You're a real hero of neutrality. So this is what's really going on. This is the meta story. This is the big story that's actually taking place. And you know, you wonder, why are these people, you know, acting crazy and willing to sacrifice, martyr themselves for the ego? Of course they're willing. Again, the ego says, I'll put a star in heaven for you. You'll be eternally in the book of my history as a great hero of neutrality. We gotta get rid of these non-neutral people, these crazy people who keep thinking that God has some salvation for them. You know, gotta get rid of them. So it is worse than we know. But in seeing how bad it is, it's great to see it. It's like, oh my God, finally I understand what's going on here. And then you say, oh, I'm sure God knows how to protect those who want to continue on, you know, the clarification of the Holy Spirit. I want to continue on. I don't want my work to be interrupted. You know, I want to continue. I want to give therapy, super therapy to people. But right now, maybe this big tsunami is coming. And it's not possible right now, but it is possible to thoroughly vet the situation and see what the ego's really up to, which I have done. So for me, I say, okay, I can go now. I've got it. Excuse me. So once you see the big picture, then you say, oh, okay, all right. Yeah, no more need to study it. get out of harm's way is what you do. And it's not that the churches, the synagogues, the temples, etc., the mosques, you know, whatever place of worship you have, again, the overall purpose is to eventually clarify what the Holy Spirit has to tell you. But it listening is a struggle. They will. But it's worth the struggle. It's worth the struggle. And we're not, we don't have to protect, we don't have to stay here and defend these places, etc. Because these places are simply meeting places where people come together and they say, okay, we're going to work on this. We can make other meeting places. You know, it doesn't have to be this building built of this material or whatever. You know, wherever people can come together, there always will be a way to congregate and focus on trying to listen. And of course, it's a struggle. But the answer is not the ego. It's not the ego. So the ego, you know, will do its work of destructivity on this planet. But we'll just move to another planet. We just move to another place. You know, that occasionally this is part of the thing. And the lesson we need to learn is we need to work at it more intensely. You got to go from crawling to walking. If you stall out on crawling, the ego gets too much momentum and says, hey, look, you guys, you're a failure. You know, what you're doing must be wrong. Therefore, you deserve, I have a better answer for you, and it's able to steamroll you. So that's why I would say that we don't need therapists, we need super therapists. We don't need pastors, we need super pastors. We don't need priests, we need super priests, etc., etc., etc. We don't need rabbis, we need super rabbis. We have to take the next step. That's why my whole life I've focused on these super therapists. Super therapists. Not therapists, super therapists. Because the next cycle of endeavor is to start to walk and then to run and then to float. And you got to get off the crawling. The crawling is not good enough. The ego catches up to you when you can only crawl. And truthfully, we've only been crawling on this planet. There's an extreme, still extreme muddled fuzziness about what the Holy Spirit has to tell us on this planet. Very fuzzy and muddled. It's crawling. And that lets the ego catch up to you. You don't want that. But you have to start out somewhere. So, you know, it's a good start, but you got to now take the next step and start to learn how to walk. And that's a whole different ballgame, isn't it? When the little toddler, you know, it's going from crawling to walking, it's like, whoa, this is completely different. But they do it. They do it. You know, we all learn how to walk somehow. You know, great determination, isn't it? Survival determination. I've got to do this. It's the same thing. We have thinking that everything is well on this planet. God will take care of us all. We can crawl forever. And it's not true, because we're still very loyal to the ego. And we keep thinking the ego, we're still intrigued by it. And so free will, we keep giving the ego power over us, and then all is not well. All is not well at all. So super therapists have to, you know, be ready. We're going to set up another big push to get people to walk, get them walking towards truth, towards clarification. It's absolutely doable. I know, because I've done it. I know that a determined, sustained push towards it works. It works. It absolutely works. You can melt away the whole guilt complex. If you really go for it and are determined, you can do it. You can do it. Anyone can do it. So, you know, we have to realize it's doable and do it. And then this whole object lesson of this cycle here is to recognize, wow, it's not enough to crawl towards God. We have to learn to walk and run, and then eventually we'll be floating in bliss. There's no objectivity. The objectivity, neutrality of the ego is a complete lie. It's a delaying, stalling tactic until it can crush you. It tells you, remain neutral. Well, if you were trying to remain neutral, you're not going towards God. You're not going towards the Holy Spirit's bliss. You're not. You're stalling out. What does the ego want you to do? It wants you to stall out, of course, because then it can catch up to you, as it were, pull you down into its demand that you entertain mutual exclusives. That's what it wants to do. And that's the worst thing ever. There's nothing worse than that. It's impossible. And then you'll feel guilty, like, how come I can't do the impossible? But then you'll know, wait a minute, it's impossible, and it's not fair for the ego to demand that I accomplish the impossible. And then you start realizing it's the ego that's not fair. And it's and the Holy Spirit's the one that's fair, because it's telling me what I can do. Is it fair to tell someone, insist that someone do what's impossible to do? It's not fair at all. So the ego's entirely unfair. That's why it's craving neutrality. It's desperate for you to be objective and neutral, because what it's asking you is completely unfair. And so if it teaches you to be neutral, then when you start to realize, wait a minute, is the ego unfair? You go, uh-oh, no, I gotta be neutral. So you never look. You never look at the ego. When you're trying to be neutral, you're not looking at, and to see, you're not seeing. You're not seeing what the ego is trying to tell you. You become a Nazi, a Nazi-er. And when you're a Nazi-er, you then are easily taught to attack those who are trying to see, thinking that they're somehow interfering with your neutral, so-called neutral position, and they're being extremely unfair. And because the ego tells you, oh, they're so unfair, they're so unfair. The ego's terrified that you might say, wait a minute, let me take a look at the ego and what it's demanding of me. And then you will no longer be neutral, because you realize that the ego is the one that's unfair. So this is a type of super therapy that I'm trying to get people to realize. Super therapy is doable. You can understand it. And, you know, there are probably other aspects to it. You maybe come across bliss at some point. But if you don't want to, you don't have to. In learning just to run, you know, I've not come across it as far as directly. I've come across it indirectly. I've never been in the presence of anyone that is blissful my entire life, never. So it's not something that is forced upon you or anything like that. But first you got to learn to clarify the whole situation. You can do that. You absolutely can do that. You know, we are reluctant to abandon this issue of neutrality and objectivity, because the ego tells us if we do, we're going to discover something terrible. Yeah, what we discover is that the ego is making this impossible demand of us, and that is terrible. Because the condition we get in when we try to fulfill its demand is a terrible, 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 terrible condition. Indescribably terrible. And so, of course, you know, we're scared of that. And the ego says, hey, it's better that you be neutral, you know. You don't want to look too closely at what's going on. But you have to look at it and see, this, I don't want this. And then you say, wait, whoa, 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 this, I'm not neutral on this. You know, this, is there some remedy for this? And then you find out, yes, there is. And they say, well, I'm not neutral on this, no way. So it destroys your neutrality. You realize that that's a farce. Neutrality is an absolute farce. It's a delaying tactic of the ego. So don't feel guilty if you're not trying to remain in this world. So I need to remain here and remain objective and neutral about all that. No, 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 no. That is one of the ego's deepest, darkest, dirtiest tricks on you. I'm not neutral at all. I'm truly objective, in that I'm objective in seeing that there's no such thing as neutrality. You're either, you know, for the ego or against the ego. And when you find out what the ego is really about, you are against the ego, period. Absolutely. You can't, there's no way you cannot be against it. Because it's demanding you to accomplish the impossible. And through the attempt, suffer unbelievable, insufferable condition. So you cannot be neutral about that. It's impossible. So being truly objective, you say, I can't be neutral. True objectivity says, I cannot be neutral. Nobody can be neutral. That's total egoic defensiveness. So I'm not neutral. Nobody's neutral. And I'm choosing bliss. I'm choosing the only choice that there really is, which is to solve the continuity problem. So I'm being totally fair, totally objective. And of course, the ego will, you know, be furiously objective to it, but so what? It's a liar. And a deceiver and a murderer from the very beginning, as Jesus told us. So this is, you know, this is great stuff to hear. And you realize, hey, it is possible to clarify all this. You know, I'm not like in a state of confusion, you know. I'm not drugged up, you know, I'm on some drug trip I'm just fantasizing all this. No, you can literally see it with very clear objectivity and clarity. True objectivity, not the false objectivity of the ego, which is neutrality, That's bogus objectivity. And that's what it teaches. It teaches bogus objectivity. And of course, those who follow that think they're like incredibly spiritually advanced, objective, you know, people. Like, wow. They think they're super advanced. Because the ego tells them that they are. The ego's so proud of them. And they think they're going to be written down in history as, you know, adepts, eventual something. No way. The ego's history is bunk, as Henry Ford would say. Yeah, absolutely it is. So the ego says, you're going to lose your spot in history. You're going to be a nothing because you couldn't obtain this neutrality. And look how all of other people are doing it. No, they're not. It's a stalling game, and they're too afraid to look at what the ego is really demanding of them. That's all. It's just a state of ignorance. It's not neutrality, it's ignorance. People say, well, maybe the Buddha taught this state of neutrality. No, Buddha said their problem is ignorance, you know, and we refuse to look at, you know, what's being demanded of us. So the ego twists all spiritual teachings to get back to this neutral state, this mythical neutral state, and wants everyone to aspire to that neutral state. And the world, the religion of the world is aspiring to this quote-unquote neutrality, which they call tolerance. You know, and they use all sorts of people. All sorts of people are willing to have themselves used by the ego in this way of demanding tolerance, so to speak. What they're really demanding is this spiritual neutrality that is neutral towards the ego. You know, the Holy Spirit, ego, I'm neutral on the issue. That is the height of delusion, to say you're neutral on that issue. It means you're ignorant on the issue. What the ego is really teaching is ignorance. Okay, that is what it's teaching. And the worldwide teaching, the worldwide religion that is being foisted on the planet is a religion of ignorance. A religion of ignorance. And people are thinking, oh yeah, that's great. If I'm just completely ignorant, everything will be solved. Yeah, no, it will not, unfortunately. Because the demand of the ego is still there, that you entertain mutual exclusives. And that's impossible. And you will... As you go down towards that, you will suffer very badly. And I said, you know, hey, I just got to find out what's going on, what's going on. I found out that, whew, okay, I got to get out of here. You know, that's the worst. So, and of course, the ego will try to stall you. But the demand is always there, because it's your own demand that you succeed in becoming prime creator, learning how to die spiritually. So, you know, again, the religion of the world that is being foisted on the entire planet is a new religion of ignorance, period. And so, of course, during this time, it's hard to be a super therapist here, because everybody's saying, wow, what are you talking about? I'm making great progress in being neutral. And you're telling me no? Are you crazy? You know, you want me to be written out of the book of history? Are you crazy? So, you know, it's probably that people have to hit rock bottom, you know, and before they lose this fantasy of neutrality, this non-existent neutrality, they'll finally say, wow, I don't want to be neutral on that. That's terrible. So those who want to really be super therapists and those who really want to get the help from the super therapists, need to sidestep the times. They need to sidestep the tsunami. The tsunami of ignorance is what is sweeping this planet. Literally is a tsunami of the deepest ignorance, masquerading as enlightenment and tolerance and a new age. It's a masquerade. And, you know, once the tsunami hits, people don't think it's so great. And afterwards, you know, say, whoa, what happened? So it's coming. This religion of intolerance is really a religion of ignorance and intolerance. Intolerance towards the truth. And intolerance to facts. So this religion of ignorance and intolerance is sweeping the planet. And people are caught up in this fervor, a religious fervor. You know, all these secular, humanistic, pagan, they're actually caught up in religious fervor that they don't recognize. they're caught up in this, drunk on the wine of their own religion of ignorance and intolerance. And it's sweeping the globe, and people are just like giddy, you know, they're giddy. Like, we're finally we're reaching this fabled neutrality, and we'll get picked to wipe out all those ignorant, intolerant people who are trying to listen to the Holy Spirit. What is that? That is just the worst thing ever, they say. That's what they say. So, there you go. This is the exposition. This is laying it bare. And it's the reason why I continue to move towards sanctuary, is knowing what's seeing this and what's going on. You have a real global religion of ignorance and intolerance that's purpose is to wipe out true tolerance and true knowledge. Okay, that's its purpose, is to wipe it out. And so then, of course, they can look around and say, gee, everyone agrees with me. I must be right. It's like, imagine if you're like a golfer and you're a pretty lousy golfer, which most of us are. And you kind of get really angry about that. And you see some good golfers, and they're so good. And you say, yeah, God, I look terrible by comparison. Just I look terrible, which is true. But you look like fools, bumbling fools. And you say, wait a minute. And the, the ego will whisper in your ear and say, hey, I know a solution to this. And you say, but what? Just look, how about if we just get rid of all these show-off good golfers? They're just showing up. They're just terrible show-offs. They're just doing this to make you look bad. That's why. Let's just get rid of them all. And then when they're all gone, you know, you'll be the best golfer around. And you won't have anything to compare yourself to. So you go out and you play a terrible round of golf. You say, hey, I did great. How'd you do? I did great. And look around and say, no, we did any better. I mean, I did as good as anybody. Or maybe, you know, so of course I did great. I'm a great golfer. Because the ego wiped out all the good ones. You see, so there's nothing to compare it but compare. So the ego wants to get rid of comparison. So there's nobody to compare yourself to that's above you. That is the leveling, this great leveling that it's trying to accomplish here in the world. Lower the bar down to zero so everybody feels like they're fine. Everybody's a zero. So you say, hey, I'm happy. You really think we get happiness from that? Because that's what the ego is advising us. That's how we get happiness. All get pulled down to the bestial level, you know, where we're all vicious and violent, murderers, killers, projections, guilt mongers, haters, intolerant, ignorant, you know, of everything. And the ego says, but you're all, no, nobody's any better than you. So, hey, you're not bad. Nobody's better. That's the ego's logic. And so is that what you really want? Because that's what's coming. That's its logic. That since there's nobody better than you, you must be the best. And so you should be happy with that. You can't help but be happy. If you're the best, why shouldn't you be happy? Because I'm trying to entertain mutual exclusives, and it's causing me to feel complete mental chaos and eternal disorientation of identity, etc. That's why I'm not happy, because I cannot tolerate that. And the ego says, well, there's nobody better than you, so you must be crazy then, because you should be happy because nobody's better than you. That's like trying to make darkness completely dark and then say you should be happy with total darkness because there's no light anywhere. Everybody's in darkness, so why shouldn't you be happy? That is the illogic of the ego. And that is what's gripping the world, is the illogic of the ego has gripped the planet. Let's lower everybody down so nobody's better than anybody else. Let's homogenize everything. What a terrible, terrible situation that is. And you should feel it in your heart saying that's the worst thing ever. You know what? I go out on a golf course, what do I want to see? I want to see those who are better than me. I always want to see those who are better than me. Whatever. I say, you know what? I'm not so good, so I need to get better. I can do it. I see they're doing it. I know I can do it. They can do it. I know I can. But I obviously got some issues that I need to work out. I got mistakes I need to correct. So that, for me, that's what I love, is I love the superstars. I love those who are really great and saying, hey, it's possible. It's possible. And they say, you can do it too, but you're too loyal to the ego, so you need to drop that. You say, okay, that's great. And when you, you know, if you play around a round of golf with really good golfers, you know what happens? You get way better. get way better. And like if I play with some people who are bumbling, really lousy, I get way worse. Way worse. That's a fact. It's a fact. So the plan is to drag everybody down. So the ego insists that we be friends with those who are way below us and who are wanted to drag us down into ignorance and intolerance. That we have those in our lives so that we get dragged down by them. It insists upon it. It's religion of quotas of this, quotas of that. It says you've got to have these, you know, pagan, very pagan, barbaric, warlike, frightened, fearful, with neutrality as their religion, dragging everybody into this fake neutrality, you know, delay tactics that you're supposed to put them in your circle of friends and let them be the leaders, that they're the role models for you. So the ego is assigning role models to us in this world. And they're the worst role models possible. And it's insisting that the good role models be wiped out, that they're evil, they're bigoted, they're intolerant, they're racist, sexist, all these, you know, pejorative terms they use. The great role models, the ego says, get rid of them, they're terrible. I want you to have these terrible role models. Those who are loyal to the ego are, the ego says, they're great role models for us, super role models. And you see them on television all the time, all the television shows. Those are terrible role models. The people I see on television are the worst role models, terrible role models. It gets even worse than that, but they are horrible role models. And the ego does not allow any good role model on television or movies, none. Shuts them out entirely, as does the internet try to shut them out. And you wonder, where are all the good role models? I can't find them anymore. They like disappeared. They've been written out of history, as it were. You know, they tried to write an onto my mod history. I tried to prevent that. But it was, you know, lost cause. The ego wants to write all good role models out of history. And the ones that it can't, like Jesus, it wants to demonize him. And then ridicule anybody who you know, tries to listen to Jesus. Not that we're very good at it. I mean, of course. There are many, 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 many people who call themselves Christians are really just pagans. Majority, actually, I would say. And they just don't get it yet at all. They've not yet learned to listen to the Holy Spirit. They think that if they just wear a cross or tattoo a cross on themselves and show up at church and just put on the act, that's good enough. That should work. It doesn't work. And they're going to find out that that doesn't work. That's just crawling. That's just crawling. That's just a little baby crawling. It doesn't work. You actually have to listen and get the right teachings. And of course, the teachers, dealing with these pagans for so long, their teaching has actually been lowered down too much. It's lowered down too much. It's too mixed. It's a mixed teaching. Just so the pagans can keep coming to church and saying, oh yeah, yeah, I'm happy. I'm okay here. The teachers are kind of like okay with me. And as long as I show up here, you know, and have good attendance record, that should be good enough. It's not good enough. It's not good enough. It's not about attendance record. It's about clarity. It's about clarity. So the teachings have to be purified again. They have to be raised up properly. And the people have to realize, hey, I've really got to get to it here. And this whole thing of putting on a show, a pretense, didn't work. Didn't work for me. Did not work for me. Okay, so, you know, and you go about your life and events happen and you think, wow, this is too much. There's no way, it's so confusing. There's no way that it can be clarified. Not true. It's not true. I've been able to clarify it. And the Holy Spirit has perfect clarity. I've been able to clarify it because of the Holy Spirit. I've not accomplished anything on my own, of my own at all. It's 100% the Holy Spirit's clarity that I just listen to. That's it. So it's not my clarity, it's the Holy Spirit's clarity. But since I am spirit too, it is part of me too. You can say that absolutely. So, but it comes from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's the one who has been attracting me to the clarity. It's attraction to the clarity that has done the job. So you can say it's a co-accomplishment, but the Holy Spirit's primary. You can say it that way. Because, of course, I've worked on it, like, you know, tremendously. But the Holy Spirit is primary. It's not me that's primary. It's not, the clarity is not coming from me primarily. You know, I'm listening to it and then accepting it. And that's important work. Of course, that has to happen too. So it's a co-accomplishment with the Holy Spirit being primary. So again, the confusion in the world now is not confusing. It's not confusing. You can see through it. But in the dust up, when the dust starts flying, you know, then it seems very confusing. And you got to get out of Dodge. That is for sure. So again, I'm pushing, you know, very intensely to, and I still haven't succeeded in the next step, which is the sidestep. The next step is a sidestepping step. And that's hard for us to do, you know, but I'm trying to do that, and have to keep working on it even more. Because I'm not satisfied at all yet that the, you know, the sidestepping, it will happen. It's got to happen. You know, I know it will, but it's still up to me. It's a co-success. Co-accomplishment. It's a co-accomplishment. I still have to do my part in that too. Okay, so, when times get crazy, as they're already crazy, it's in the back of your mind, you say, well, you know, I know that the Holy Spirit's not confused by this, so I can keep listening to the Holy Spirit. It will clarify and show me, ah. And above all else, do not get sucked into the great lie of neutrality, as I pointed out in this video. Very important. If you can see this and start getting the sense of it, whoa, you know, then you're truly blessed. You're walking, you know. You've been able to get past this neutrality issue, which is, it just came up for me yesterday, and I hadn't even seen it before. I knew there was something wrong. I didn't know what it was, and then I saw it. I said, oh my gosh. So much of religious teachings have been towards this neutrality. It's ego. Those are ego teachings. And that's really hamstrung me in this world, because there's this religious, spiritual establishment in the world based on the ego's teachings that said to me, hey, you're way off track, buddy. You know, you're kind of completely backwards. And if you want to be written down in history as a spiritual adept, you need to learn the truth. And then they tried to teach the truth, this neutrality nonsense, this rubbish. And they're still trying to teach this rubbish. And of course, that gets in the way of the bliss. You know, they say, no, that's wrong. That's wrong. You got it wrong. You need to have this, you know, objective state. Neutral. I mean, this neutral state. That's what you really need to have. So, it's been a super struggle to get past this. It's difficult to come into the world and witness to the truth. It's difficult because the default spiritual establishment of the ego in this world will really go after you. Really go after you. But here we are, still standing and ready for the sidestep. Okay, that's it for this one. Hang in there. Trust in the clarity of the Holy Spirit. It's always there for you.